Hello, dear viewer. A very warm welcome to this lesson. Primary 5 is the class we are going to be discussing social studies. And today, we are privileged. We are going to be having a new topic, meaning we are going to start looking at or discussing a new topic. And this topic comes last in our class. I mean, it is the very last topic that we have in our primary 5 syllabus. What is it about? It is about the population size and distribution in relation to economic planning and development. Which means we are going to look at a lot of things in this topic. We are going to talk about population, we are going to talk about development, we are going to talk about planning in Uganda, and a lot of things in this topic of population size and distribution in relation to economic planning and development. In our workbooks, for us who have the workbooks, following them, we have this on page 79. Now, the first thing we need to note is there are going to be terms which we are going to have to define, which we are going to define in this topic. The first term is for us to understand the meaning of population itself. Population, which we define as the total number of people who are living in an area or in a country. That is what we define as population. So when we talk about population, what are we meaning? We are meaning the people. Population is the total number of people, the total number of people who are living in an area. Therefore, we have what we call the study of the population changes. That is what we are going to define as demography. What is demography? Demography refers to the study of population changes. The study of population changes is what we define as demography. So that is the first thing that we are beginning with. Understanding population as the total number of people who live in an area or in a country. Then we also need to note that the study of the population, the study of the population changes, or simply the study of population, is what we term as demography. So in this lesson, in this topic, we are going to be looking at demography. That we have said, it refers to the study of the population. Now, in line with the population, there are terms which we are to define, terms used in population. Terms used in population. There are a number of terms that we are going to be having here. Number one, we shall have what we call population distribution. We shall be coming to talk about these terms one by one. Population distribution. We shall have population census. Population census as our next term. We shall have a population explosion. Population explosion. We shall have population structure. We shall also understand what we mean by population structure. We shall also talk about population growth. population growth. Then we shall also be able to talk about dense population. We shall have sparse population. We shall have high population. High population. We shall have low population. Also defined. We shall have optimum population. Optimum. Optimum population. And others. That is what we are going to look at. So you'll find that these terms are very many, which are in line with population. All of them take us to population. I think we cannot, let us add, before we conclude, let us also put what we call population density. Population density. This is also something which is very, very interesting that we are going to be looking at here. We shall have population density and others as I have written. Now, for us to be able to define this, we are going to talk about all of these one by one. And we are going to begin with population distribution. Population distribution. Now, just like we are hearing the word distribution, distribute, distribution, it simply means the way how people are spread in different parts of an area. The way people are scattered, distributed in different parts of an area. So that is what we mean by population distribution. Population distribution is the way how people are scattered. If we can't write scattered, we can say how people are spread in different parts. In different parts of an area. So that is what we mean by population distribution. How people are spread or scattered in different parts of an area. You will find that some areas have got very many people settling in them, whereas others have got a few people settled in them. That is what we are terming as here. Now, we are going to look at the factors. Factors of population distribution, which means we are having an area having many people, some areas having a few people. Which factors bring this? One, we have the presence of social services. And when we talk about social services, we cover a lot of answers here. We have social services like education, good security. We have social services like good transport network, health, like health services provided to the people in that area. That will make the people to become very many in that area. And then we also have other factors like the presence of jobs in an area. We have this on our page 87. If you are having the book, you can join me on page 87. You will find that page 87 gives us the factors that that cause population distribution. And of course, here we are having two. We can have the other ones of an area having very many people, that is a high population, and then an area having few people, having a low population. So what brings, we have said,
an area which is having very many people. We have the presence of social services that we have written, and we shall have availability of jobs in that area, and we shall simply say presence of jobs in that area can also make people to become very many in that area. Then when it comes to we also have the presence of economic activities done. Though this one joins our jobs to a certain extent, presence of economic activities like job chances that people can be doing. And then we also have improved infrastructure in an area. Then you look at the negative side of it, what makes people to be few in that area, you will find we shall have factors like infertile soil or infertile soil, unfavorable climate, that is the poor climate of an area. It makes people not want to settle in that area. We shall also be looking at other factors like insecurity in an area. Like if there is a war breaking out in an area, you will find people run away. And as a result, that area has few people. Or people will not even be wanting to camp that area. As a result, the area is going to be having a low population. Then we also talk about other social services like poor education services given to the people in that area, poor health services. All those contribute or bring what we call the factors of population distribution. We are looking at how people are spread in different parts of an area. Next is what we call population census. Population census. Census deals with the counting of people. So what we call a national census, we call it the official, a national census is the official counting of people in a country, in an area or country. Here we are looking at the country. Now we have got another term. That was our second term here. We are done with distribution, we are on census. The counting of people, the official counting. Sometimes we call it the general counting of people in an area. Now we shall be able to ask, what are the reasons for counting these people? Reasons for conducting a census. Why does the government of Uganda carry out population census? Why does it have to count people? Of course, we need to know that the first reason why people count or why people are counted is to get their total number. Like when you are in class, you are in primary 5, and the teacher says, the teacher maybe begins saying, boys stand up, girls stand up, the teacher is going to count. What does the teacher want? The teacher wants to get the total number. So here, the first reason is to get the total number of people, not now in a class, but we are looking at in a country. That is reason number one when you are asked, why does the government of Uganda carry out population census? To find out the total number of people living in that country. Number two, after getting to know the total number of people, the government is now going to plan for these people. So we can simply say to plan for the people in that country. To plan for the people. Then the other one is, the government also counts people in order to get what we call the population structure. We shall be coming to look at that. To know the population the population structure. Now we are going to first of all understand what we mean by population structure. I'm not going to wrap these terms because we are going to be following them. Kindly be following the lesson. We are saying population structure, we can make it as NB. Population structure, we have it here, it means the number of people, or we can see that we can say is the composition of people in a country, composition of people in terms of their sex. The composition of people in terms of their sex. This is what we call gender. Of course, we need to know that when we are asked for our sex, we are either, sex is in either male or female. So here we are looking at how many males are in a country, how many females are in a country. That's what you call population structure. The composition of people or the number of people living in an area according to their gender. So the government also carries out population census to find out that how many people in Uganda are females, how many are males. That is about population structure. The other one is, the government also carries out, that is number three, number four, the government carries out population structure, I mean population census, in order to find out the death rates. Death rates. This refers to the rates at which people die. Remember, we shall be able to say that population census is always conducted after a period of 10 years in Uganda. After 10 years, another census will be conducted. Another counting of people will be conducted. Which means, within the 10 years, there are people who will have died. So the government computes, finds out how many people died within that period. That composition, that computing is done, and is what we simply term as death rates, to know how many people died. Then also, we also have another point which is about finding out, or we can simply say to know the birth rates. Birth rates. So much as the government finds out how many people died in that period, the government also gets to know how many new children were born. That is what you call the birth rates in that country. Then lastly, for now, we can say the government also carries out a population census in order to know the education levels of people in the country. To know the education levels, we can simply say the literacy levels. That's why we shall find that during this exercise, there are people who are trained to carry out this exercise. We are done with the reasons for counting people. Now we are going to look at the people who do the counting. We call them the enumerators. We should have added that also here. Enumerators. It is another term we use in population. Enumerators. And we are finishing it. Enumerators are the people who are trained to move from one house to another during a population census. What happens is you find these people coming with the books to get the information from one house to another, house door to door, as they are collecting the information. Those people are called enumerators. We can simply say enumerators are people who count others during a census. So, we have what we call a census night. We shall also be having it, census night. A census night simply refers to the night before the day for counting people. Night before the census. Like, if tomorrow we are going to have the census beginning, so we'll find that the night to tomorrow is what we call a census night, a night before the day for carrying out population census. Now, we are looking at the enumerators, and we are saying the enumerators are the people who carry out, who count others during that population census. Those people collect data that we call information, which we are going to look at. Which information do they collect when they come to our homes? They find out the number of people in the family. They find out the number of people in the family. They find out the education levels of people. They will be asking education levels. They find out the living standards of people, like how many meals do you eat a day, like that. By doing that, the government wants to find out the living standards of people. That should have been our seventh point here. But because of time, we left it out. But it's good that we have brought it, to find out the living standards of people. So they will find the living standards of people. Living standards of people, meaning how are people, what level, are people very poor? Are they coming out of the poverty line? Are they trying life? What are the people, which activities do people do? All those ones will help to raise what we call the living standards. So next we shall, they will also be asking for the animals kept. Which animals do you keep in this home? How many meals do you eat in a day? How many boys are here? So all that is what we term as data that these people collect, all the information that they collect. For that case, we are done with population structure. It is here. And we are removing it, that we continue with the enumerators. Remember, we are still on population census. Now, these enumerators face problems. They face problems. We can call this subheading problems faced by the enumerators. Which means, as these people are doing their work, moving from one household to another, counting people, there are some challenges that they face. Which are these problems? Number one, they lack proper facilitation. Poor facilitation. Sometimes you find they are given very little money and they will be doing a lot of work. Sometimes these people are affected by the poor weather. You find as someone is beginning moving from one house to another, rain pours. You are supposed to try to reach every house. If not, there is too much sunshine. That's about poor weather. Next problem they face is these people have, there is what we call poor attitude from other people. From other people. Remember, this is a government program that the government is using in order to get the number of people in the country. But sometimes you find that some people become arrogant. They don't want to be counted. They reach someone's gate, they know, they ask, who is that? I'm an enumerator, please go away. We're not after that. So you'll find that some people do not want to talk to them. So they are, that is what we call poor attitude of the people. Then there is also another problem of wrong information given to them. These people are given wrong information or data. Some people give wrong information that they are called data. So you find that people give them, instead of telling them the truth, they lie. How many people do you have here? They say we are 20 people, yet there are only 5 people. That is the wrong information, of which it will make the government not to get the rightful statistics for these people. If not, they can say we are maybe 5 people, and yet there are 10. So at the end of it all, you'll find that since the government wants to plan for these people, the government will be planning now for the few, and yet there were other people who were left aside. So that becomes a very big challenge to the government when it comes to planning now. That has been under a population census that we find in our book on page, we have it on page 80. We have it on page 80. Now, we shall be able also to have page 80 gives us also the note. One is telling us the ministry responsible for conducting population census, that is the Ministry of Planning, I mean Finance, Planning and Economic Development. And then we also have the board that is UBOS, the Uganda Bureau of Statistics, which is in charge of the population activities in the country. Then we are saying it is conducted after a period of 10 years. And the reason is, it is always very expensive. It cannot be conducted every year because it is very expensive. It needs a lot of money. Then secondly, it needs some changes to be allowed to take place. For example, if it was to be conducted every year, you'll find that by the time they conduct the next year, they might get the same number. So that will be just wasting time. At least after 10 years, we'll find that some changes will have taken place. Some people will have died, then others will have been born. That is what we call now the death rates and the birth rates, as we talked about. So, we are now going to look at population growth. Population structure is done. We are going to population growth. Population growth simply means the increase. From the word growth, it means the increase of people in an area. That is how simple we can define that. We shall come to population explosion. I haven't forgotten it. Population growth. Population growth is the increase, meaning the number is growing, meaning it's increasing, the increase of people in an area. Of course, that will make us to understand that there is something that makes people to increase in an area. What makes people to increase in an area? Number one, the area has got fertile soils. The fertile soil in an area. Number two, this area has got good security. Presence of a security makes people to go and stay in that area, and they become the number goes high, number increases. Next is we have presence of jobs, availability of jobs. There are many jobs in that area. So as many people go to that area, the number will increase in that area. That will become also another factor that brings the number to increase. And then we also have the presence of good social services like health. Presence of good health services. Good health services. We shall have trade chances or trade opportunities or business opportunities. You find that people can go to that area and they begin some businesses, and the area can become overpopulated. And other factors that make people to go to that area. So, when this happens, the number will increase steadily. Number increases steadily. Then, what we call population explosion. Explosion comes from explode. You know, something which explodes from nowhere. Like a bomb has exploded. So when you talk about population explosion, we mean the sudden, from nowhere, the number increases. So that is a population explosion. Population explosion, we simply define it as the sudden. Sometimes, if we can't write sudden, we can say it refers to the rapid increase of people in an area. Which means, all of a sudden, from nowhere, the number has become too much, too high. It is not like for population growth. I want you to get the difference here. Population growth means that steady increase. Steadily, the number increases slowly, slowly. The area has got good jobs, so people keep on coming slowly, slowly, till the area develops or has many people. The number increases. But with explosion, the number of people increases within the shortest time possible. People are too many. That's what you call the sudden increase in the number of people who are living in an area. Now, we shall also be able to look at what brings the population increase. I mean, what brings that population, that sudden increase. Here we shall be looking at factors mainly, among others, as refugees. We can call it refugee influx. Refugee influx. Refugee influx means refugees pouring into a country. A refugee is a person who runs to another country because of some factors that are beyond one's control in his or her own country. For example, if a war is in Republic of Congo, DRC, you will find that there are people who are going to run away. To escape death, they will run to neighboring countries which are secure, which are not having the war. And one of the neighboring countries can be Uganda. Now, when those people come to that country, when they come to Uganda, they become refugees. Now, you will find that these people can make the number of people to go high, to shoot high from nowhere. The country has become too populated, or maybe highly populated, because of these people who have just poured. So that pouring of refugees in an area is what we call refugee influx. When very many refugees pour or come to an area. So that is what we have as population explosion. Others can also follow the same. We shall have the presence of good security. Remember, this will also make now the number. I mean, the presence of security is already what we have talked about as refugees. Of course, when they are in that area, they will be safe. Then we have also others like good social services. We shall have factors like the presence of jobs in an area. People can go to work there, and they become too many. Then we also have the outbreaks of some natural disasters. For example, we have landslides in an area. We have landslides. When the landslides occur, people have now to run to other areas very fast. And as a result, they pour there. We need the shortest time possible, the number will have gone high. Next is we have other factors like eruption. Eruption, people still run away, and as they run the neighboring area, which is safe, the number goes high. So all those factors make the number of people to increase in an area very fast. So that has been about population growth. Then dense population, we are looking at an area having very many people. An area which has very many people. And this dense population is brought by the population growth or population explosion. An area which has very many people, or having very many people living in an area. And then we also have sparse population. Sparse means few, which means that area has got few people living in that area. Of course, we shall be able to get the reasons. Why are people few in an area? The area has infertile soil, it has poor climate, there is insecurity, there are no jobs in that area. Such things bring that, make people to be few in that area. There are no improved social services for the people, so people ignore such places and they go to others which are better. And of course, they become dense, too many. The factors will stay for this population. Coming to a high population, here now we are going to compare people with the resources available. High population is when the number of people is higher than or more than the resources which are available to be utilized by those people. Then low population is when the number of people in an area is less than the resources which are available. And of course, when the people are too many compared to the resources, you will find that it will bring what we call a shortage of shortage of resources. Some people will lack some resources. Then when it comes to low population, you will again find that the people are few compared to the resources. So it will again lead to wastage of resources. That is the disadvantage of this low population. Then we have optimum. Optimum deals with equalness now. We are looking at the number of people being equal to the resources available. It solves the problem of this high population, low population. Optimum population is when the number of people is equal to the resources which are available in that area. Then we move to population density. This is what I want to have some writing about, population density. Population density. We define it as the total number of people, the total number of people living in an area, living in an area per square kilometers. Per square kilometers. That per square kilometers is, we are going to have some calculations. We can remove this. We are having the number of people living in an area per square kilometers. And this is going to be calculated. That's why when we have our, when we go to, I think page, let me check. Okay. Fine. Thank you, this.
On page 91, yeah, we have got it. Page 91, open that to that page, go to that page. You will find that we have the formula. We calculate population distribution, which we can write as PD, is equal to the total number of people. Total number of people living in that area per square kilometers. That is the area now covered, which is in square kilometers. So that is the formula. The total number of people divided by, that is called per square kilometers, which means we are going to have an example. I don't want to use the example which is in the book. I can give you another example. We can say an area, we can use where our school is. We can say Mugorobi, which is maybe 200 kilometers, that is 200 square kilometers, has a population of maybe, let me not, I hope I'm not using the one, the population which is given here. Mm-hmm. Has a population of 800,000 people. Find, it is a population density. Meaning we are going to find the population density of Mugorobi. We shall follow our formula. In mathematics, we need to have that formula for us to be able to follow. Population density equals the total number of people, or we can simply say the number of people divided by the area which is covered. Then we continue following our calculation. What is the total number of people? It has a population of 800,000. Population is the number of people. So these are now the people. 800,000. We are dividing it by the area covered. What is the area? Which is 200 square kilometers. 200. Remember, our answer is going to be in up here. These are people. Divided by square kilometers. That we can write it as people per square kilometers. These are the units. Your answer must be in these units. If not, you will not get a tick. Which we can compute, we can divide this by this, this by this. We have 2 into 2 ones. 2 enters into 8, 4 times, and then we shall have the other zeros not affected. 1, 2, 3. So our answer will be 4,000. And we have said when you end there, no mark. Why? We need to see the units. The units are, these are people per square kilometers. So that is our answer. That is what was done for the answer to be got. That is on page 91. You can follow that as your exercise as well as your example. They have given you a district, that is Kabong,
has 200,000 people. And the area is 200 square kilometers. Find its population density. And you have seen there, the formula is very simple. They have said population density, that is PD, equals the total number of people out of the area covered. Now, what did they do here? They say, the total number of people in Kabul, according to the question, is 200,000. We hope it is the right one. Yes, 200,000. And these people are divided by the area covered, which is 200 square kilometers. 200. Remember, this one's up, we have people out of the square kilometers. These are the units. So if we are to divide this, we shall have two enters into two ones, two enters into two ones. Then we copy the remaining zeros which are not affected. One, two, three. One, two, three. So our final answer will be 1,000 people per square kilometers. That is the answer we got for that question, which is on your page 91. It is very simple, and I believe you have followed and you have got to know what I mean, how to answer this question. I mean, how to calculate the population density. It's just very simple. So when we meet next time, we shall be looking at people moving from one place to another. That will be under migration. But for now, I want to end this lesson there. Then I wish you the very best of your time. Thank you for joining me. Thank you for watching. Thank you for being a good listener.